Hi, everybody. Welcome. You are not in the wrong place. I am not Brad Keeler, Director of ASCE's Geo-Institute, but I'm Teresa Engler, Executive Director of Deep Foundations Institute, or DFI, coming to you live from GI's YouTube channel. DFI and GI are pleased to be collaborating on the fourth International Symposium for Offshore Geotechnics. And in case you haven't heard, it will be held live on August 28th to the 31st in Austin, Texas. So please get that in your calendars, plan to attend, and also note that registration opens March 16th. So just bookmark ISFOG2020.org and you'll find it and you'll be able to do that right away. So today I am here to introduce you to symposium co-chairs via this sneak peek into the event by introducing this live stream workshop. But before we move on to the presentation, I just want to tell you a little bit about DFI. If you're not familiar with us, we are a practice-oriented international membership association. We're comprised of about 4,000 geotechnical professionals that are involved in design and consulting or contracting, both specialty and general contractors. We have manufacturers and suppliers of equipment and materials that support those deep foundation construction projects, as well as the public and private owners, professors, and students, all interested in that segment of our industry. So we come together through DFI's forum to find common ground. You may have heard that before, on all industry challenges. They share their experience in the field and they find consensus and provide some valuable guidance documents. They do that through over 25 committees. We also produce a bi-monthly magazine, a peer-reviewed journal, and we have a podcast channel. So if you haven't seen all of this, please check out dfi.org. So now to the presentation that you signed up for. I'm going to introduce Bob Gilbert of the University of Texas at Austin, who is the symposium co-chair, and he will introduce our other co-chair, Philippe Jeanjean of BP, who will present today's pre-symposium workshop. Bob, off to you.
Thanks, Teresa. The GI really appreciates the opportunity to collaborate with DFI on this symposium. So we are going to be doing a pre-symposium webinar in advance of ISFOG 2020, which will actually be held due to the pandemic in August of 2022. Could you go to the next slide, please, Philippe? As Teresa mentioned, early registration opens on March 16th, so a little less than a month away. The conference itself is going to be in person. We're hoping as many people as possible are able to travel and participate in person in Austin, Texas. We've got 6 one-hour pre-conference workshops, and we've got 6 pre-conference webinars that go hand in hand with those one-hour pre-conference workshops, and this is the second of those. The proceedings have already been published and are available. They were published in August of 2020, and they are available, and if you purchase the proceedings, that goes toward your conference registration. Next slide, please. So the 6 pre-conference webinars, which go with the 6 pre-conference workshops the day before the conference starts, are shown here. This is number 2, and we're going to be talking about PY curves for piles and clays. The next webinar will be a little less than a month from now, right before the early registration starts. And that will be dealing with CPT-based methods for designing piles in sands. And Farouk Nadim and Barry Lehane will be leading that webinar. Next slide, please. So we've got a number of sponsors already signed up for this conference. We have platinum sponsors Benthic, Fugro, TDI Brooks, GeoQuip Marine, Sealaska, and NGI. We have a gold sponsor, BP, a silver sponsor, Geosyntec, and 2 bronze sponsors, the Center for Offshore Foundation Systems and the National Geotechnical Centrifuge Facility in Australia. We want to thank all of these sponsors. The only way to push the frontiers in offshore geotechnics is to be working collaboratively with industry. And that's a very important part of not only our profession, but also of the ISFOG symposium. So thank you very much to our sponsors. Next slide. I'm very pleased now to introduce the seminar speaker, Dr. Philippe Jeanjean. Philippe has almost 30 years of experience in offshore geotechnical engineering. He holds undergraduate degrees from France and graduate degrees from Texas A&M University. He's an expert in offshore geotechnics and site investigation. He has been actively involved throughout his career in a number of industry groups that have pushed the practice forward. Some of the changes that have been made under Philippe's leadership are amazing in the API and ISO guidance documents when you look at the history of those documents. They are not easy to change, and Philippe has been a significant leader in getting some of those changes, including what we're going to be talking about here today. And last, Philippe is a co-chair in the ISFOG 2020 conference. So we thank you for all of your service to the industry, Philippe, and I'm going to turn over the floor to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bob, for this kind introduction. It's my pleasure to present this webinar on the proposed ISO API PY curves for piles and clays on behalf of myself, Arash Zachary, Yuhu Zhang, and Knut Anderson. So by the end of this webinar, you will understand the key features of the new proposed ISO PY curves and clays for monotonic, cyclic, and fatigue actions. You will understand how they compare with the current guidance in the ISO and API codes, and you will understand how they compare with the recently developed offshore wind monopile design practices, such as those of the PISA GIP. Now, today we're not covering the extensive calibration and validation of these curves against pilot tests, finite element analysis, laboratory testing, and wellhead monitoring. These are covered in other publications. What we're talking about today is laterally loaded pile design in clays. So almost all piles offshore are designed through beam column analysis and PY curves, in which the pile is idealized as a beam and the soil is idealized as a series of springs that describe the generation of soil lateral reaction P as a function of pile lateral displacement Y, so-called PY springs. Now, those techniques are appropriate for the analysis of long flexible piles where the soil is assumed to move only laterally and the pile tip does not move, so there is no need to model. The curves in the current API and ISO codes are based on monotonic and cyclic tests performed in the late 50s, early 60s at the Sabine River site by Professor Matlock. They were published in the industry in 1970 and included in API practice in 1972. They've served us very well. However, they are widely documented now to underpredict both soil stiffness and strength. So the reason why we have been using them for 50 years, typically they will overpredict the maximum bending moment in the pile, which is one of the key quantities we're trying to estimate. However, the industry needs increased efficiencies, so there will be updates to the ISO and API geotechnical codes, hopefully to be published this year, and you will have now PY curves for monotonic, cyclic, and fatigue loading conditions based on the work that myself and others have done over the years. So what do you do first when you derive a PY curve? You first have to worry about the ultimate soil resistance, PU, and then you try to figure out the shape of the PY curve. So let's start with PU. The ultimate soil resistance per unit length, PU, is equal to the shear strength times the pile diameter times a lateral bearing capacity factor. So the name of the game is trying to calculate this bearing capacity factor. For a laterally loaded pile, if there is a gap in the backside of the pile, the failure mechanism consists of a wedge in front of the pile close to the ground surface. Then with depth, this failure mechanism transfers and transforms into a flow around failure. The bearing capacity factor for the flow around failure mechanism is just called NPD, D for deep. And in the wedge, the bearing capacity factor has two components, NP0 which is the component due to the shear strength of the soil. And you have this term, gamma Z over SU, which is the component due to the weight of the soil. So typically, you will get a profile with depth of bearing capacity factor that looks something like this. Now, if you have no gapping on the back of the pile, you now have two wedges, one in front and one in the back. Far from the soil surface, the flow around mechanism is unaffected, so NP is still equal to NPD. But in the wedge mechanism now, the bearing capacity factor is equal to 2 times NP0, which accounts for the strength of the front wedge, the passive wedge, and the strength of the soil in the active wedge. The weight of the soil cancels out because the passive wedge in the front goes up and the active wedge goes down. And typically, you will get a profile of bearing capacity factor that looks like this. So let's start first with the flow around mechanism. That's the simplest one. The current API ISO practice is based on the work of Matlock. And in his days, he had published theoretical values that range between 8 and 12. And he said that a maximum value of about 9 appears to be reasonable and is tentatively adopted in 1962. And to this date, this is what you'll see in the codes. NPD equals 9 in the absence of more definitive criteria. The new framework will use the results of upper bound plastic limit analysis of Randolph and Hosby. And very simply, NPD is equal to 9 plus 3 alpha. Alpha is the pile adhesion factor, which ranges from 0 if the pile is smooth to 1 if the pile is fully rough. So immediately you can see that the new bearing capacity factor will always be greater than the current. Now, in the wedge mechanism, you can see of the wedge that was studied by Rees in 1958. Matlock used this framework and derived this equation to interpret the results of the Sabine River test. This is the NP0 component that accounts for the shear strength of the soil, and this is the weight of the soil component. So implicitly, you can see that this equation assumes that there is a gap in the back of the pile. New ISO practice uses a slightly more intricate shape for the wedge. You can see it here. It's a dome-shaped wedge. And with refinements of this upper bound analysis with FEA analysis, finite element analysis, this equation was derived for NP0. So you can see that the equation depends on Z, the depth, the diameter of the pile, and the shear strength profile. So SU0 is the shear strength intercept at the seafloor, and SU1 is the average slope up to the depth of interest. Now, I've been talking about SU, so which SU do I mean? So if you look at the test from the Sabine River site, you can see that Professor Matlock had results from unconfined triaxial compression test and results from mini-vein test. This is the design profile that he used to interpret the test. And as you can see, they are based on mini-vein data. However, you can see that in the top 10 diameters, there is quite a scatter in the data. And later on, other investigators chose different profiles to interpret the same test. So this is what we have in the ISO text currently for axial capacity. UU triaxial is recommended. However, the text says that consideration should be given to the sampling and testing techniques used to correlate the shear strength to any available relevant pile loading test data, which means simply that if Matlock used mini vanes to derive his design profile, then we should do the same. We should use mini vanes. But in practice, that's not always what we do. So in the new text proposed for axial capacity, we have a text that captures better what we do in practice, which is combining results of testing on unconsolidated samples, such as UU triaxial or mini vanes, with results of tests on consolidated samples, direct simple shear, DSS, or consolidated triaxial test, and in situ tests, such as the cone, the T-bar, or in situ veins. For the lateral analysis of piles, the new framework uses the strength measured in a direct simple shear test, the SUDSS. Why is that? Well, that's because most of the mechanism is controlled by the flow around failure, and the stress path in this failure mechanism is idealized to be closest to that in a direct simple shear test. Now, we realize that in the wedge and close to the seafloor, that's not quite correct, and the idealized stress path is closer to that in a triaxial extension test. So how do we deal with that? We calculate the bearing capacity factor with the equation I just showed you, and then we correct it with a factor that accounts for soil anisotropy and the ratio of SU in a triaxial extension test over SU in a direct simple shear test. So in essence, at the seafloor, we are using the triaxial extension strength, and then we transition throughout the wedge. And at the bottom of the wedge, we use the DSS test. If there is no gapping, then you have a wedge in the back. And here at the seafloor, you should be using the triaxial compression test. So if you want to look at both wedges, you should use the average of triaxial compression and triaxial extension. As luck would have it, for most soils, that average is actually very close to the DSS strength. So if you have no gapping, there is actually no correction to be used, and you can go and derive your design profile using the DSS test results. Now let's look at the shape of the normalized PY curves, the soil resistance P over the ultimate resistance as a function of wide lateral pile displacement normalized by the pile diameter. We're all very familiar with the parabola proposed by Professor Matlock. There is this epsilon C parameter, which is based on work by Skenton and UU triaxial test, because as I showed you, there were no UU tests available at the Sabine site. What's interesting is that stiffer soils have lower epsilon C and therefore exhibit stiffer normalized behavior. So this is the shape of the parabola for an epsilon C of 2%. And this is how it was discretized when it was first implemented in API in 1972. Clearly, we didn't pay attention to the small displacement range. What was of interest was the ultimate capacity. And it stayed that way until 2007, when we added two points here on the curve to try to better capture the small displacement behavior. For the new framework, we use a scaling method, and by which we take laboratory stress strain curve and we scale them to obtain PY curves. Now, that is not a new idea. This was actually proposed by McLennan and Fosch in 1958, and they used triaxial test in their work. But what we do is we run a DSS test, we normalize the test results, and we use this curve to define soil plastic property and hardening laws. We implement those in a finite elements model, push the pile laterally, and we measure the resistance P of the pile as a function of Y, displacement of the pile, and we can derive a normalized PY curve. So you do a lot of parametric studies, and eventually we come up with scaling procedures that allow you to take any point on a normalized DSS curve and transform it into an equivalent point on the normalized PY curve. And you'll see in ISO there are two scaling methods recommended. But most of the time you won't have to do that. We have an extensive database of 537 DSS tests that we used to provide six default PY curves as a function of plasticity index and overconsolidation ratio. So you can see the three curves for a plasticity index greater than 30% and the three curve for the plasticity index less than 30%. Interestingly now, the stiffer soil, the higher the OCR, the softer the normalized response is. So that is opposite of what the Matlock framework used to tell us. So let's take a practical example. I have a linear increasing shear strength profile. You can see the pile diameter. You can see the anisotropy ratio, fully rough pile, no gapping. And in the flow around mechanism, This is what the current API PY curve would look like. This quantity here is nothing more than the bearing capacity factor. So it ends at 9. And this is what the new curve would look like. And again, the bearing capacity factor is 9 plus 3 alpha, which is in this case 12. But you can see that for small displacement, the curve is also stiffer than the old one. So this is for the monotonic PY curves. Now, offshore, we have to design structures against hurricane, typhoons, and cyclones. And you can see the path of some of those over the last 50 years. As you can see, pretty much anywhere you are in the world, you have to deal with those. And even in areas where you don't, such as the North Sea, you have severe winter storm. So this is a little video of a winter storm hitting a platform in the North Sea. So you can see this wave here, which is about a 20 meter high wave hitting the platform and right under the deck of the platform, right there. So how do we deal with those cyclic loads? Well, we studied the behavior of clays under cyclic loads. And again, we used the direct simple shear test. So now we're going to talk about cyclic effects. So cyclic effects have two components. First, you have rate effects, which tell us that the shear strength increases if the rate of shearing increases, because soils are viscous materials. And it's also, there's also a component due to cyclic degradation that tells us that the shear strength decreases if the number of cycle increases, because with each cycle, the soil gets a little bit more remolded. So the net effect of cyclic loads on the shear strength is not always easy to calculate. So how do we do that? Well, in the test, in the lab, we take a DSS soil sample and we apply an average stress and a cyclic stress at a period of about 10 seconds. And we measure the response of the soil, which is the average shear strain and the cyclic shear strain. And now I can plot one variable against the other and I can generate cyclic stress strain curves. And they look something like this. And I continue the test until I reach a shear strain of 15%, which we arbitrarily define as failure. So the cyclic shear strength is an average and cyclic stresses at failure. And I can do a series of tests for all kinds of combinations of average and cyclic stresses, and again, measure the response. And instead of focusing on failure, I can focus on any number of cycles. So for example, at 10 cycles, I can measure the average and cyclic strains, the response of the soil. So in the lab, the average and cyclic strains can be measured for any combination of average and cyclic stresses, either at failure or after any number of cycles. And typically we look at 1, 10, 100, and 1,000 cycles. Now, once we have that information, we can draw what are called strain contour diagrams. And you can see an example here for Gulf of Mexico clays and after 10 cycles. So each of those little dots here is a test result. And then we can draw those contour lines of average and cyclic stresses. So for clarity, let's remove the data points and we're left with these diagrams. So those diagrams are very, very powerful. For example, in the horizontal axis, the cyclic stress is zero. Therefore, on this curve, on this axis here, what I have is nothing more than the monotonic DSS curve. This point here at 15 and 1 is this point here at 15% and 1 on this curve. This point, this purple dot is this purple dot. This red dot is this red dot. So you can see there's a one-to-one equivalence between the monotonic response and this horizontal axis here. So now if I know something about my load path and my cyclic loads, for example, for typical Gulf of Mexico hurricanes, we know that the cyclic stress is about 1.3 times the average stress. So I can draw that straight line on this diagram. And now if I take this point here, I can measure an average and cyclic stress, and I can measure on the red and blue lines an average and cyclic strain. So I can plot this point here on this. I take this yellow dot, this, and I can plot it here. And if I do that enough time, I can generate this curve. Well, this curve is a cyclic DSS curve for 10 cycles for Gulf of Mexico clays for this particular load path. And I can try to derive scaling parameters to approximate this cyclic curve by scaling the monotonic curve. And every time I have a DSS curve, I can scale them using the procedures that I either one of the two recommended by ISO, and I can get cyclic PY curves. This is how we get cyclic DSS curve, and we scale them to get cyclic PY curves. But you can see that those curves are calibrated for Gulf of Mexico and North Sea clays, because these are the blue and red lines, and for Gulf of Mexico hurricanes and North Sea storms. If you had a storm that had a loading path like this, you would get different modifiers. So again, the P and Y modifier to get this purple dot to something here can be obtained if I know the number of cycles that are being applied on the pile. So now the question becomes, how many cycles are applied on a pile during a hurricane or North Sea storm? So how do we do that? Well, what we're trying to do fundamentally is predict the stresses and deformations in the pile at the end of the peak period of the hurricane when the maximum load is assumed to occur. So you can see here the significant wave height normalized, ramping up and having a peak period and then a ramp down or decay. So what we do is we don't really worry about the decay, and we only analyze the ramp up and the peak period. So we do time domain analysis, and we extract total pile load at the pile head as a function of time, from which we can get the average and the cyclic component. We rearrange this time series, and we simplify it into parcels of total, of equal total and average loads. And you get a diagram like this. So you can see that a Gulf of Mexico hurricane typically applies about 6,000 cycles of loads on the pile head. And the first parcel here has about 2,500 cycles at this very low load level. And then you can see how the load ramp up with each cycle. So now I take my beam column model, and I start with monotonic PY curve. And let's take a very practical example where we apply 30 cycles at a stress level of 0.75, and then we follow that with 16 cycles at a stress level of 0.85. What I can do with all the that I measured is derive those contours that describe the cyclic strain generation as a function of cycles. So I start with my first parcel, my 30 cycles, and I look down here to see what my equivalent number of cycles is. Well, there's only one parcel, so n equivalent is 30. That's easy. Then I go in this diagram for n equals 30, and on this trace, on this line here, as I just showed you, I generate my cyclic DSS curve. I scale it, and I get my cyclic PY curve. Then I go back into my beam column model, and I update my monotonic springs with the cyclic springs I just calculated. Now I apply my second set of loading. So I go up the charts and apply 16 cycles at 0.85, and I look down again, and now I have a new number of equivalent cycles, 19. So what this diagram tells you is that 30 cycles of the green plus 16 cycle of the blue is equivalent to 19 cycles of the blue. So again, I go in this diagram for n equals 19 now. Again, I derive a cyclic DSS curve. I scale it. I get a cyclic PY curve. And again, I update my model, and I go back and back and back and forth until I get through the entire storm. And at the end, I obtain the number of equivalent cycles, that is the number of cycles that would have produced the same cyclic effect as the entire previous load history at the end of the storm. So what did we find? We found that this number of equivalent cycles is dependent on where you are along the pile. So we introduced this normalized parameter, Z over Z rotation. So the rotation depth of the pile is where the displacements are zero for the first time. You can calculate it with monotonic springs, or you can approximate it as 15 diameter. And the number of equivalent cycles depends also on where you are on the PY curve, the degree of mobilization. So we introduced this parameter, which is the ratio of the mobilized P, which in this case, for this point here would be 9.6, divided by the ultimate, which is 12. And from those two parameters, we introduced this hybrid factor, HF, which is a function both of the mobilization level and the normalized depth along the pile. And what we did is we did a lot of parametric beam column analysis, cyclic beam column analysis, and you can see the length of the piles that we used, the diameter of the piles that we used, all the wall thicknesses that we used, all the head restraint conditions that we used, and all the pile roughness that we used. And for each of those cases, you calculate and you plot the number of equivalent cycles as a function of this hybrid factor, and you try to draw a regression line, and this is the equation. It's going to be in ISO to calculate the number of equivalent cycles. So what does this equation tell you? It tells you that if you are close to the rotation depth and at low mobilization, when you calculate the hybrid factor, you'll be in that part of the diagram. There is very little cyclic effect, and the number of equivalent cycle is very low. However, if you're in the yellow zone, if you are close to the seafloor and you have high mobilization, when you calculate the hybrid factor, you're in this part of the diagram. That's where the cyclic effects are at the highest, and at the maximum, you have up to 25 number of cycles or equivalent cycles. So the overall, the thing makes sense. Deep and at low mobilization, very little cyclic effect. Close to the seafloor, high mobilization on the P1, and low cyclic effects. So this is how, now we have the number of cycles, and this is the curves that we came up with that are going to be in ISO to calculate the P modifier. So this is the straight line. You have North Sea soft clays, Gulf of Mexico, and North Sea stiff clays. What's important to note is that most of the time, this P modifier is higher than one, which means that most of the time, the rate effects will dominate over the cyclic degradation during the cyclic loading of the pile. For the Y modifier, it's a little bit more complicated. Sometimes it's higher than one, sometimes it's lower than one. But this graph here will be in ISO, or at least has been proposed to be in ISO. So let's take, again, the same practical example, and let's look down the pile to see what those cyclic curves look like in practice. So this is my monotonic curve for a plasticity index of greater than 30% or CR less than 2. And these are the two cyclic curves at the seafloor and close to the seafloor. So you can see that the ultimate P is almost the same as the monotonic one, which means that cyclic effects are, which means that rate effects almost cancel out exactly the cyclic degradation. So the cyclic effects are very small. As I go down the pile, the yellow dot, the green dot, the blue dot, all the way to the depth of rotation, there's less and less cyclic effects. And now the rate effect starts to dominate quite a bit. And you can see how the curves get stronger and stronger with depth. If you are below the rotation depth, the curve is the same and there is no more cyclic effects. So you can see how a single point on the monotonic curve gets scaled to various points here as you go down the pile. But again, most of the time the cyclic curve will be stiffer and stronger than the monotonic one. So this is not what is in the current code. So why is that? Well, with all the cyclic data that you collect in the lab, you can draw those failure interaction diagrams here. So here on the axis, you have the cyclic strength over the monotonic strength as a function of the average stress and as a function of the number of cycles. So you have curves here for Drummond and Gulf of Mexico plates. So as you saw, for Gulf of Mexico hurricanes or North Sea storms, we typically have number of cycles between 1 and 25. So we're in this region of the diagram here. So if I look here, I can see that, well, on average, my cyclic strength is higher than my monotonic one. So it makes sense that the cyclic PY curve is stiffer than the monotonic one. However, when Professor Matlock ran his test at the Sabine River site, he applied 300 and 400 cycles of cyclic loads, which we know now is not representative of what actually happens offshore on a platform during a hurricane or winter storm. And if you look here, you can see that on the axis, the cyclic strength is less than the monotonic one. So that explains why, in principle, if you have your current monotonic curve, the cyclic curves in the flow around mechanism is less, because this cyclic curve corresponds to hundreds of cycles. So cyclic degradation wins. This is our new monotonic curve and platform. We're in this part of the diagram, and rate effect win, and the cyclic strength is stiffer. So that's the big difference between the existing framework and the new framework, which is more representative of what is actually happening offshore. Here is another way to look at it. You have all those cycles here. The key thing to remember is that our reference is the monotonic curve, which looks something like this, with a rate of shearing of typically 5% per hour, which means the sample typically fails in 1 to 3 hours. So you can see here, as a function of the number of cycles, there's a zone where the cyclic response is stiffer than the monotonic one, because again, rate effect dominant. For example, if I have failure in 10 cycles, 10 cycles at 10 seconds, that's 100 seconds. So this is here the rate effect between failure in 100 seconds versus failure in 1 to 3 hours. But as I have more cycles, you can see here that eventually cyclic degradation wins and the response is softer than the monotonic one. A word of caution, if you read the literature, things can get very confusing. You'll see publications where people say the P modifier or cyclic degradation is always less than one. Soils always degrade under cyclic load. Why is that? Well, that's because those investigators use a different reference curve. They use the first quarter cycle curve as their reference, and then they try to modify this curve to get this one and this one. So sure, if you do that, in principle, there's nothing wrong with it, but you've intrinsically accounted for rate effects, and now you're only accounting for cyclic degradation. So this is not what the new ISO framework does. Again, the reference is the monotonic curve, because this is what we have a lot of experience and a lot of databases on. So this concludes the discussion on cyclic curves. Now let's look at the last type of curve. There's no current recommendation in ISO and API on soil structure interaction for fatigue analysis. What we're interested in fatigue is the steady state condition. You can have a monotonic loading, and then you have cycles, and eventually those loops will stabilize, and you can have a steady state secant stiffness. We focus on the steady state because in fatigue, damage is not the absolute stress in the steel that is of interest. It is the changes, the cyclic stress in the steel that causes damage. So we developed two models, one that we call the spring-only model that is applicable for piles and well conductors, and another model which we call the spring dashpot model, which is available or applicable for time domain analysis of subsea conductor wellhead BOP riser systems. So the PY curves were developed from centrifuge tests and direct measurements with a novel laboratory PY testing apparatus. So remember, what we're interested in now is the very low sea states that cause the most fatigue damage. So for the low sea states, the period of the waves is about 2 to 4 seconds. So this is what we're interested in now. So this is the apparatus in the lab. We have a soil sample. We can consolidate it to any effective stress we want. We insert a rod in the sample, and then we cycle this rod laterally throughout the sample. You can see the sample here mounted in the apparatus, and this is what it looks like in the lab. So this is an example of the cyclic PRY curve. You can see, hopefully, it's not too jerky. You can see the rod moving back and forth at the end of the test where the displacements are quite high. At the end of the test, you can cut a slice of your sample, and here's what you see. If you squint a little bit, you can actually see the deformation pattern in the sample around the rod. And if you try to superimpose that pattern with the characteristic slip line pattern of the upper bound failure mechanism of Randolph and Hulsvik, you actually get a very good match. And you get a very good match also with the predictions that we made using finite element analysis. So overall, what we observe in those tests seem to make a lot of sense as compared to theory. So what do? We perform tests at various displacement levels. So I apply a displacement level, the displacement, and I measure P, the resistance against the rod, with each cycle. And as you can see, after a couple of thousand cycles, I will reach a steady state. So I can run various tests at various displacement level, and I can plot those normalized PY curve, P over PU versus Y over D. So this is an example here where we have five motions, and I can plot those loops, and I can focus on the last cycle, the steady state cycle, and I can just measure a steady state secant stiffness normalized. It's just the ratio of Y over X. I can also measure the area of that curve in red, and from that idealized shape of the curve, I can derive psi, the damping ratio, and then I can derive C, the viscous damping coefficient that I need in my model to characterize my dashpot. So this is how we get secant stiffness and dashpot parameters in the spring dashpot model. So if you take those five motions here, this particular test, you can plot the secant stiffness as a function of Y over D. And for this particular test, this is what the data looks like. You run a bunch of tests, and then you draw kind of a best fit line that we use for the spring dashpot model. For the spring only model, we have this curve here, which is arbitrarily drawn here to try to capture the combined stiffness of the spring and the dashpot. So this is the same data, but now the x-axis is on a logarithmic scale. What is important to note is that for fatigue analysis, really the most critical range of displacement is between 0.1 and 1% of the diameter, so in our experience. So for a 1 meter pile, I'm talking about 1 millimeter to 1 centimeter lateral displacement at the seafloor, very small displacement. So I have my secant stiffness, and I can convert that into a PY curve. This is the equation that has been proposed for ISO. AS and BS are parameters that are given for various conditions. PU here is the ultimate lateral soil resistance calculated monotonic, calculated with the no gapping conditions. You see, gapping necessitates a certain amount of lateral displacement to occur, and you're not going to get those large lateral displacement in fatigue analysis. So just an example of typical curves. This is the curve for the spring dashpot model. It would look something like this in practice. And this is the curve for the spring only model that would look something like this, because they were derived from different secant stiffnesses. So again, this green curve here, this green springs, is tries to combine the of that red spring plus that dashpot. So if I go back to my example, here are the two monotonic curves, the current one and the proposed one. Here are the two cyclic curves, the current one and the proposed one. And here is the spring-only fatigue curves, which we cut off at 5% of the diameter, because you shouldn't need to go higher than that for fatigue analysis. So if I extend the x-axis a little bit, you can see again, we have a lot of discretization up to 1% of the diameter, because this is where all the action is in our experience when we do fatigue analysis. So all of what I've told you applies to oil and gas piles, which have a diameter of up to 2.5 meters, a length of up to 140 meters, and a ratio L over D greater than 30. So those would be long and flexible piles. And you can see an example of those on a barge here, and you can see people on the barge to get the scale. So that's what a 140 meter long pile looks like. In the offshore wind industry, monopiles are used. They have a much larger diameter to give you the required foundation stiffness. Their embedded length is less because the axial loads are less. So they have an aspect ratio between 2 and 6. So this is what we would call short and rigid piles. And you can see again here, they're still spectacular piles in the yard. So to address the design of offshore wind monopiles, the PISA project develops a new approach based on finite element analysis and actual testing. So one of the tests were done at Cowden in Glacial Till. And you can see the shear strength profile at Cowden along with the shear strength measurements. And you can see the shear strength, the small strain modulus measurements with the modulus interpreted profile. So there is some scatter in the data, which tells you about the difficulties and challenges in characterizing glacial till sediments. You can see that the project did a series of tests at various diameters and aspect ratios. So from this, the PISA project developed a design method, which consists of performing a series of finite element analysis for the site conditions and a range of diameter, length, height, load application height, and wall thicknesses. And if you do that, you'll see that the soil along the pile, along the monopile, not only moves laterally, but also vertically. And now the pile tip moves laterally and rotates. So the project has generated a model, a 1D beam column model that has 4 reaction curves, a lateral load distributed moment curve, and 2 curves of the base to try to capture those 4 displacement components. Now, the distributed laterally loaded curves are meant to model the lateral pile displacement, which is exactly what our PY curves are supposed to do. Here's the equations that have been published by the PISA project for the Cowden site, the bearing capacity factor, which is called P bar ultimate in the PISA lingo, is given here. And you can see the shape of the normalized PY curve as given by this equation. So you can see that although this is supposed to model exactly what the PY curve models, it's expressed mathematically very, very differently. So the question is, how does the PISA compare? How do those equations compare with the ones I just showed you? Well, you can take a look at the PISA test. So you have 2 tests here. And for the shear strength and pile conditions and so forth, you can use the ISO method, the new ISO method, and calculate a bearing capacity factor versus depth for 2 piles. Then you compare that with the empirical relation that was published, and you actually get a very reasonable match. PISA project also did finite element analysis from which they extracted PY bearing capacity factors. Here is the data. So you can see that you have a region of low bearing capacity factors. This is the region close to the rotation depth of the pile where the bearing capacity factor has not been fully mobilized. So we ignore those data. Again, you can use the new ISO method, calculate the bearing capacity factor, and you'll get something that is very close. Now let's compare the shape of the PY curve. For one of the tests, CL2, you can see the 2 ISO default curve for OCR less than 2 and OCR 4, and you can see the curve that was measured for an OCR of 3.7, an excellent match. A little further up the pile, OCR is 10. You can see the default ISO curve and the curve that was actually measured. So the ultimate resistance is not too far off, And yes, the measured curve is a little stiffer than what ISO would predict. But remember, there's a lot of uncertainty in the shear strength in the shear strength and the shear modulus, which would affect where exactly what this curve is. Now, PY curves were also extracted from the finite element analysis performed in the PISA project. You can see them here. And this is a green curve that ISO would recommend. So there is an excellent match between the FE analysis from PISA and the ISO recommended curve. Only this red curve here, which has an OCR of 3.5, should be a little closer to this ISO curve for an OCR of 4. But overall, we get a good match with the shape of the PY curves also. Now we can look also at the fatigue curves. Now what we present here are preliminary observations based on the results of cyclic testing published in two University of Oxford's dissertations. So this file CM7 was subjected to about 3,800 cycles of load between 2 and 30 second period. So again, we go back into the database that was used to derive the two secant stiffness curves that are in the ISO model. So this is a little different database and curves than before. Before, that was our database for normally consolidated soil. This is the database for oval consolidated soil. And this is the PISA data. This is the same data, but with a logarithmic x-axis, and you can see a very reasonable match between the PISA and the ISO curves. So from those stiffened secant stiffnesses, I can derive PY curves. So for this particular pile, this is the ISO spring dashboard curve, and this is the spring only curve. And this is where, if I plot the PISA result, the data falls very close to the spring dashboard curve. Now, when we developed the ISO recommendations for the damping recommendations, this is the database of tests that we have for the steady state damping ratio as a function of normalized displacement. This is the trend that is implied by the numbers in the new ISO code, future ISO code. And this is where the data from PISA plots. So again, very consistent with the underlying ISO curves. So when you do a test, it's very important to understand that what you should expect to measure is something close to the spring dashboard curve and this damping curve. You should not expect to measure something close to this spring-only curve, which again is a little bit of an artificial curve that combines this stiffness plus the stiffness of the dashboard. Now, this spring-only curve has been validated many times, again, load test and online monitoring. So we feel it's very reliable, but it's not something you actually measure. So these are the main references I quoted in the presentation. If you're interested, you can watch the recording of this webinar and investigate a little further for yourself. And this is the end of the webinar. So I trust that now you understand the key features of the new proposed ISO curves. You understand how they compare with the current guidance in ISO and API, and you compare with the recent, and you understand how they compare with the recently developed PISA recommendations. So again, the PISA recommendations as published for the Cowden site and the future ISO framework are very consistent one with the other, even though the mathematics is very different. We are saying the same thing, although we express it mathematically very differently. So as mentioned, we'll have a workshop on August 28th, and I just wanted to give you a teaser of perhaps what we'll be doing. I was thinking maybe we'll do some practical exercises. I'll give you a DSS stress strain curve, and you can scale it using the two procedures in ISO and develop your own monotonic PY curve. In case you have a site that falls outside conventional soils, perhaps due to mineralogy or structure, and you'll see that once the spreadsheet is set up, it's literally a 30-second exercise. Anybody can do it. And I thought perhaps I would address frequently asked questions. In particular, is there a diameter effect for PY curves? Are PY curves really low displacement curves? I talked about gapping or no gapping. Well, what do I do? What do I assume? And if you're familiar with the current MATLAB framework, close to the seafloor, those curves show softening, but ours don't. Why is that? And you can come with any questions you have. And at the end of the day, it's the workshop is all yours. And also, perhaps we can talk about which PY curve to use for the analysis of which structures, fixed, floating, subsea, for various basins around the world, for various limit states. So with this, I hope to look forward to seeing you in Austin, August 28th, and I'll give the floor back to Bob. Over to you, Bob.
Thank you very much, Philippe. That was fantastic. So I have a few questions for you before the workshop itself. First of all, in your role as a senior geotechnical advisor for BP, can you talk a little bit about what the motivation was for looking at PY curves decades after they were codified and became the standard of practice?
The work started in the early 2000s in 2003 for fatigue analysis of conductors. We had conductors that, if we used current backbone monotonic PY curves, were not meeting the minimum fatigue lives. So we started a series of centrifuge tests at C-Core and did some finite element work with Sage and Jack Templeton. And that's what was published in 2009. And then we refined the work because one of the fundamental limitations of current models is they cannot replicate the failure mechanism that we observe offshore. As you're well aware, we rarely see foundation failure. We also see the foundation in the jacket truss itself, not the piles. And you cannot explain that with the current framework. But with the new framework, the motivation was develop models that are capable of replicating what we observe in terms of damage and failure mechanisms, so we can much better have a true idea of the platform reliability.
And along those lines, can you talk about some work that's been done to look at field evidence for these new curves?
Yes, there's a paper by Fu Wu in OTC 2020 that compares predicted versus observed platform damage during Hurricane Harvey and Gustav. We have monitoring of wellhead motions. So we monitor riser and wellhead motions, and we hindcast those with the new fatigue curves. We have pilot tests. In 2017, we hindcasted, I think, about more than a dozen pilot tests, monotonic, to validate the monotonic curve. We also look at the Sabine River cyclic test, the cyclic test at Haga in Norway, performed in the 80s, the cyclic test performed by the Salcy project in France, and with the new cyclic PY curve framework, we can hindcast all those cyclic test results quite satisfactorily. So.
And in your presentation, you talked about the proposed. Do you have any sense of when the proposed may become the current?
My hope is 2022. It might be early 2023, but the text has been written for a few years now and has already undergone tremendous scrutiny and verification by the members of the API and ISO committees, verification agencies, universities. So I think it's been battle proven already because it's been written for a few years now. So.
Thanks. Another question is, how would you take this framework and apply it to cyclic loads due to seismic loading?
So we have a paper at OTC. I think the main author was Bob Litton and a few co-authors, where we did some centrifuge tests and in soft clays and using the backbone curves with the appropriate shear strength that account for rate effects and the appropriate damping formulation, particularly radial damping formulation, we were able to hindcast the bending moment measured in the centrifuge with what we predicted. So we feel confident that indeed with the details and the caveat in the papers, you can apply those curves to for seismic design.
Another question is about sample disturbance and how you navigate having disturbed samples that you then run the direct simple shear tests on.
So the database that we have of 500 plus DSS tests includes at least four offshore contractors. They include samples recovered in rotary boring and from jumbo piston cores from the mid-90s to about a few years ago. So they span all 25 years. So whatever typical disturbance you get in the field, we feel has been captured in the database.
Okay. Another question is how you would deal with layering. So if you had a strength profile that was not linear or continuous with depth.
So if you have that, there is a procedure for non-linear profile. The slope is the average slope, so there's a little equation there. But the math doesn't work for cases where you have a crust at the seafloor, because you will get a negative slope if you have a crust and then the shear strength decreases. So Texas A&M and there was a PhD student, Francisco Gravias, did some work, some plastic limit analysis, and we published some results in 2017 that tell you exactly what you do to calculate bearing capacity factors in profiles with crust. And those references will be in ISO. So if that's the case, you can look it up if you have a profile with crust.
Thanks. And let me save the best one for last. What to do with silt?
What to do with silts? Avoid them. So silts, you have fine grain and coarse grain. So assuming it's a fine grain silt, ISO and API is silent on the topic. My personal view is that as long as you can reliably characterize the stress strain deformation in the lab in the DSS test, and it's a cohesive material, then you can use the scaling procedures that we've developed. You may be a little bit outside in terms of plasticity and Gmax over ratio rigidity index than we have in our database, but again, that's published, so you can check that. And again, as long as you have reliable DSS tests, I feel personally that you scale those DSS curves for silts.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Jeanjean. With that, I think we're ready to close the seminar. Again, a reminder, we hope to see you all in August of 2022 for ISFOG 2020. Thank you, Philippe.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks, Philippe. Thanks, Bob. Yep. I think you reminded them of everything, but, you know, just want to thank you both for all the time and effort you put into not just today's workshop teaser, but also the planning. It's been going on, I think, since 2018, and we're excited to see this come off in August in Austin, 28th to 31st. And don't forget, registration opens March 16th. And the day before that, we'll have another workshop teaser that you can sign up for through the ISFOG 2020 website, through the link there. That'll take you to Eventbrite again. So we encourage you to do that. And check out DFI and GI's other activities on DFI.org and Geoinstitute.org. Because of all of you and your involvement and participation in our programs, we can keep bringing great things to you. So, yeah. Just keep coming back and doing some good stuff here. Thanks, Bob. Thanks, Philippe.